Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents An Earthling's Guide to Outer Space, Everything You Ever Wanted to Know About Black Holes, Dwarf Planets, Aliens, and More, by Bob McDonald. Narrated by Bob McDonald. Dedicated to curious minds everywhere. Part 1. The Great Beyond. Answers to the Big Questions. 1. How big is our galaxy? Our Earth is floating through a beautiful whirlpool of stars almost too large to imagine. We call our galaxy the Milky Way because it looks like someone spilled milk across the night sky. You can see it with your own eyes, but it's a little tricky. You have to find a dark place where there are no streetlights, away from towns and cities on a clear night when the moon is not up. If you can find a spot like that, in the country, beside a lake, on a farm, and look up on a summer night, you'll see a ghostly glow arching across the entire sky, a bridge of stars that reaches from horizon to horizon. That's our home galaxy. But there's much more to it than meets the eye. Looking up from the ground at night, we don't see the whole galaxy because we're inside it, the same way you can't see your entire town or city from your front door. If you could soar above the Milky Way, what a spectacular sight you would witness. A luminous swirl of stars with four graceful curving arms wrapping around one another in a pinwheel shape. Our sun is just one of hundreds of billions of stars on that merry-go-round. We live on the inside edge of one of the galaxy's curving arms, about two-thirds of the way out from the center, and the nearest star to our sun is more than 4 years away at the speed of light. If you wanted to travel around the entire galaxy the way fictional starships in movies do, you'd need a fast ship, one that could move at the speed of light at the very least, and that is crazy fast. At light speed, you'd cover 300,000 kilometers or 7 times around the Earth in 1 second. You could visit the moon and come home again in 1.5 seconds, or travel to Mars in 20 minutes. But even traveling at that incredible speed, it would still take you 30,000 years to travel from Earth to the center of the galaxy. And if you tried to cross from one side to the other, it would take 100,000 years. If you could make the journey to the center of the galaxy, you'd see it for what it truly is, a city of stars. About 300,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000, number is so huge it's hard to wrap your head around. But you can get a sense of how many that is by imagining every star as a grain of sand. If you pick up a handful of sand, you're holding a few thousand grains. That's about the number of stars you can see with your eyes on a clear night. But that's only a tiny fraction of what's really out there. An average dump truck holds approximately as many grains of sand as there are stars in the Milky Way. Imagine that dump truck full of sand spread out roughly 30 meters across, or the area of a baseball diamond. That's the size of our galaxy. But it's only one of about 100,000 million other galaxies that make up the rest of the known universe. So, how many stars are there in the universe? At least this many. 2,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000, If all the stars in the universe were turned into grains of sand, they would cover all the beaches in the world. After you've pondered that, pick up just one little grain of sand on the end of your finger and look at it. That's one star, our sun. At that scale, the Earth is not even visible to your eye. The universe is incredibly vast and filled with an unimaginable number of stars. It can make you feel small and insignificant when you think about it all. But remember this. We may be small, but at least we know our place in the universe. Of course, for now, we don't have any spaceships that can take us across the galaxy, so we have to journey there in our imaginations. To do so, lie on the ground. Don't think about the sky as up. Think about it as a huge space that reaches out in all directions. Remember, there are just as many stars below you as there are above, because you're lying on a big ball. And you're not on top of the ball, that's the North Pole. You're somewhere on the side. The next time you see a globe of the Earth, find your city and see what side you live on. If you think of yourself like a fly on the wall, with the ground behind you instead of below you, and the stars in front of you instead of above you, you'll get a truer sense of your place in space. Space places. Take a walk through the Milky Way galaxy in the Galaxy Garden in Hawaii. This big circular garden was designed in the exact shape of the Milky Way, with different plants representing the stars and nebulae. A funnel-shaped fountain in the middle of the garden represents the black hole in the center of the galaxy, and all of the plants are arranged in curving arms that resemble the spiral shape of our galaxy. If you want to find the Earth, you'll have to look hard, because on the scale of this garden, it's too small to see with the eye. But there is a spot, a little more than halfway out from the center fountain, where a little dot on the leaf of one plant represents our sun. The future is now. It doesn't happen very often, but every once in a while, two galaxies run into each other. Don't worry, no one gets hurt. Galaxies are mostly made of empty space, with the stars so far apart that two galaxies can pass right through each other without anything actually touching. But when they get too close, gravity can pull them out of shape, rearranging those long spiral arms. Eventually, our Milky Way is going to collide with the next biggest galaxy close to us, Andromeda. Luckily, that won't happen for another 4 billion years. And when it does, though, there will be two Milky Ways in the sky. You try it. Model galaxy. What you need: 1. A large bowl. 2. Water. 3. Food coloring or milk. What to do: 1. Fill the bowl with water. 2. Using your finger, swirl the water around in a circle until it dips down a little in the center. 3. Let the water spin on its own for 5 seconds. Then, carefully pour just 1 or 2 drops of food coloring or milk in the center. 4. Watch the shape the food coloring or milk takes. 5. You have just made a model of the Milky Way. The food coloring or milk should take on a spiral shape, with long arms wrapped around the center of the bowl. That is the shape of our Milky Way galaxy. The sun and billions of other stars all swarm around a central bulge. Galaxies come in many different shapes, but the spirals like ours are the most beautiful. Don't you agree? 2. Is there life in space? With so many stars and planets in the universe, it seems silly to think that we're living on the only planet with life. So, if there are alien life forms out there, where are they? No other life has been found on worlds other than Earth, but that doesn't mean it's not out there. Consider how many different forms of life there are on our planet. Plants and animals have found ways to live in extreme environments, not only in lush jungles and forests, but also in hot, dry deserts, in frigid ice, and even in boiling water at the bottom of the ocean. Living things that survive in extreme environments are called extremophiles. And if extremophiles can exist in the most challenging landscapes on Earth, what about in weird environments on other worlds? Could there be life in the incredibly cold, dry deserts of Mars? Might there be creatures floating around in the orange clouds of Jupiter? Or strange life forms hiding under the ice of distant moons? We don't know the answers to these questions yet, but one thing we do know is that when we find life on other worlds, it probably won't be the little people with big heads and huge eyes we see in the movies. Those movie aliens are often large creatures, too, but when we do find life on other worlds, there's a good chance it'll be very small. Higher life forms of life, like animals, fish, and birds, take billions of years to evolve. We will likely find microscopic cells floating in water, simple plants, or pond scum. That's what life on Earth was like for most of its history. And even today, there are far more insects and microscopic creatures than there are people or elephants. Another thing to consider is that all life you see around you, whether plant, animal, bird, or insect, is made of the same basic ingredient as you are, carbon. Some scientists have suggested that alien life could be based on another element, such as silicon, which makes up rocks and sand. Can you imagine living rocks? We might not even recognize them as alive. Alien life may be so strange-looking to us, we might have a hard time relating to it. So, where do we start our search for life in other worlds? We've begun our search on Mars using robots. Mars is cold and dry today, but scientists believe there used to be lakes, rivers, and even an ocean on its surface about 3 billion years ago, roughly the same time that life was just starting to appear on planet Earth. Once upon a time, you could have gone swimming and sailing on Mars. Was there life in those Martian oceans? That's one of the questions our robots are trying to answer. They're searching for signs of life, but so far they haven't turned up anything. Today, Mars remains covered with markings that look like rivers and lakes. The only problem is that we don't see any water in them. It seems they dried up when Mars went into an ice age. Today, it's hard to find a place on Mars that isn't below freezing, which decreases the chances of finding alien life forms. But maybe we're looking in the wrong places. What if there's life in Mars rather than on it? There may be caves where it's warmer and wetter, caverns where extremophiles could survive. The problem is you have to know where the entrances to Martian caves are. So far, our robotic rovers haven't had much luck finding any. And even if we do find caves on Mars, there's another problem. The air on Mars is different from the air on Earth. Martian air doesn't have oxygen in it, so we won't recognize any life we find there. One thing we see on Mars is lots of ice. Ice is everywhere in space. And we already know that even in the coldest places on Earth, microscopic life can survive. If life can exist underneath ice on Earth, perhaps we could find life under the ice on Mars. All we need is some way of digging down into that frozen water to find it. Some scientists think there's a better chance of finding life on Europa, one of Jupiter's moons, than on Mars. Europa is completely covered in ice. And under that ice is an ocean containing more salt water than all of the oceans on Earth. There could be hot water vents at the bottom, similar to those on our planet, with their own kind of microscopic extremophile life. Another way we might find out if there's life in space is through space probes sent to comets. When the satellite Stardust flew to a comet in 2004, it scooped up some material from the comet's tail, then returned to Earth. The comet dust it retrieved contains the same basic chemicals, called organics, that life is made of. Which begs the question, is it possible that life on Earth came from comets? This concept has a name, panspermia, meaning life that spreads around the universe via comets. Microscopic organisms, or even the chemicals that make up life, buried deep inside an icy comet, could be protected from the harsh environment of space for millions of years. Then, when a comet strikes a planet such as Earth, which is warm and has lots of water, those life-giving ingredients may become the seeds for a whole generation of creatures. We know that the Earth has been hit by comets many times in the distant past. What does this mean? Maybe we're all descendants of alien matter from space. If you're old enough, you may recall ads for sea monkeys in the backs of comic books. Newsflash, there's no such thing as a sea monkey. These creatures are actually tiny shrimp, and they have an amazing ability to survive when their ponds dry up. They can dry out so much that they look like dirt and appear dead. They can stay in this state of suspended animation for many, many years. To bring them fully back to life, all you need to do is put them in water. It's astounding how something that seemed dead can come back to life. This kind of hibernation could allow life to travel through space hidden inside a comet. How many seeds of life are floating around out there right now, just waiting to run into a warm, wet planet like ours? When we search for life on other worlds, this is the type of creature we're likely to run into first. They're life forms that, in many ways, are more resilient than us. Other planets may have water, but they are frozen planets. Venus, on the other hand, is a hot planet, where water, if there is any, would exist only as a gas. The Earth is right in the middle. It's sort of like Goldilocks, not too hot, not too cold, but just right. Astronomers call this mid-range the habitable zone, or the Goldilocks zone. In our solar system, this zone extends inward just a little toward Venus and outward to Mars. Astronomers and scientists continue to look for planets that might be habitable like ours somewhere in the galaxy. We have found a few, but no signs of life yet. On the drawing board, is there anyone out there we can talk to? With all the billions of stars and billions of galaxies in the universe, it seems unlikely we are the only intelligent life. One way to search for other communicative civilizations is to listen for radio signals. We've been keeping an ear out for aliens for some time now. A number of radio telescopes use a process called SETI, Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence, to listen for alien radio signals. So far, nothing has turned up. If you want to join the search for aliens, you can help through a project called SETI at Home. There are so many signals coming from space that scientists can't analyze them all. Through SETI at Home, you can link your computer to a worldwide network that looks for alien signals in the data gathered by telescopes. Maybe you will be the first to locate a signal from an alien civilization. You try it. Alien linguistics. What would you say to an alien if you had the chance? What you need. 1. Blank paper. 2. Markers, pens, or colored pencils. 3. A few friends. What to do? 1. Divide yourselves into pairs. Each pair should have one piece of paper and a couple of writing utensils. 2. Separate yourselves so you can't see what the others are doing. 3. Come up with a message that you would like to send to an alien civilization. It could be a greeting that says hello. Or perhaps you are in trouble and need to ask for help. Or maybe you want to invite them to come visit. Be creative, and don't tell the other group what you're trying to say. 4. Write your message on the paper for the other group. 1 rule, you cannot use English words, numbers, or any symbols that we use on Earth because the aliens will not know our language. It has to be some kind of drawing that gets your message across. When you've completed your message, gather everyone back together and see if the other pairs can understand your message. Can you understand what they were trying to say to you? It's harder than you think. 3. Where do stars come from? Stars come from clouds. Just as clouds in the sky make raindrops, enormous clouds in space give birth to stars. Space clouds are called nebulae. They look like beautiful space flowers drifting among the stars. Some are so large it would take longer than your entire life to cross from one side to the other, even if you were moving at the speed of light. Nebulae are mostly made of hydrogen gas, which is very light, and they are found everywhere in the universe. It makes sense, then, that most stars, including our sun, are made almost entirely of hydrogen, too. But while these nebulae are beautiful to look at through a telescope, if you were to pass through one on a spaceship, they sure wouldn't smell like flowers. They're full of dust and other carbon-based gases that are similar to what comes out of a car's tailpipe. So nebulae would probably smell like a combination of vehicle exhaust, smoke, and burned hamburger. The plus side? That space pollution is the fertilizer for new solar systems. Clouds in space usually have some parts that are thicker than others. And in space, whenever anything, whether it's gas or rocks, gather together in clumps, these clumps have more gravity than the rest of the material around them. The clumps within a space cloud attract more gas and dust, And as they do, their gravity grows, squeezing everything toward the center until a ball is formed. If that ball gets big enough, the center becomes extremely hot. Nuclear fires ignite, and a star is born. Meanwhile, other smaller clumps of matter, the ones that don't fall into the center and become the star itself, circle around the new star, forming little balls that eventually grow to become planets. This is how the Earth and all the planets in our solar system were formed 4.5 billion years ago. You might be wondering, where did those big clouds in space come from in the first place? It turns out that many nebulae come from old stars that died a long time ago. Stars are born, but they also die. And when they do, their remains become new stars. Stars can live for billions of years. Ours, the Sun, is 4.5 billion years old, but only halfway through its life. Eventually, every star runs out of gas. The nuclear fires inside stop pushing outwards, and gravity crushes the star down, squeezing it into a smaller space. The squeezing makes the center of the star even hotter, and for a short while, a different kind of burning at the center of the star begins pushing back out again. This puffs the star out into a big red giant. When our Sun reaches this stage of its life, that will be the end of Earth and all life on it. The Sun will completely fill our skies. Temperatures on Earth will quickly rise until the oceans boil into steam, forming thick clouds around the whole planet. The heat of the big Sun will burn these clouds off into space, giving the Earth a long white tail like a comet. As the hot gases from the swollen Sun surround the Earth, mountains will melt into valleys until the whole planet turns into a molten ball of boiling rock that will eventually become a burned-out cinder inside a dying star. But let's look at the upside. With one final dying gasp, the Sun will blow off its outer layers, along with the debris from what was our solar system, all of which will drift off into space, forming a brand new nebula. From the death of stars comes the life of new stars and planets. If you've ever wondered what happens to stars when they stop shining, touch your face. We are made of stardust. Today we live, but one day we will die. The atoms in our body will be incorporated into the ground, and then a long time from now, the Earth and everything on it will be vaporized and cast out into space, where parts of it will reform into beautiful nebulae. Who knows? Perhaps one day, way in the future, the atoms that make up your body will become part of a planet going around a new star. Maybe life will evolve on that planet, and one of those life forms will look up into the night sky and wonder where it all came from. To a faraway alien astronomer 4 billion years from now, our Sun's nebula will probably look like a ring or a shell. That's because our Sun is a fairly average-sized star. But there are giant stars out there, much bigger than our Sun, and when they die, they go out with a bang called a supernova. Supernovas are so violent and hot, they act like giant blast furnaces, forging heavy elements like nickel and gold. Think about that. When you see a gold ring or any piece of gold jewelry, you are looking at an element that was made not by the Earth, but inside a dying star during a supernova explosion billions of years ago. You can see an awe-inspiring nebula with your own eyes. All you need to do is find the constellation Orion. Orion comes around every winter and is the most easily recognized star pattern after the Big Dipper. The three stars in a row are the belt. Hanging from it is a sword marked by three more stars pointing downwards. With binoculars, you'll see that the middle point of the sword looks a bit fuzzy. The misty part isn't actually a star, but a nebula. This gigantic cloud, almost 1,500 light years from Earth, is a cosmic nursery containing hundreds of stars still in the process of forming, plus other stars already born. Four of them, together known as the trapezium, are baby suns that flared to life less than 1 million years ago. The intensely hot trapezium stars are what make the Orion Nebula glow. On the drawing board. Here's a wild idea. We might someday build a spaceship called the Interstellar Ramjet that uses clouds in space as rocket fuel. It would be a very large ship sent far away to other star systems. If the journey involved passing through a giant hydrogen cloud, the ship would extend an enormous invisible scoop made of a magnetic field. The field would gather up some of the gas floating in space and funnel it into the ship's engines. There, the hydrogen would be burned and blown out the back end of the ship, making it go faster. A ship like this could theoretically go faster than any vehicle ever made, cutting down the travel time to the stars. There's just one little problem we still have to solve. Once you get a ship this large traveling that fast, how do you stop it? 4. What is dark matter? Space seems to be mostly empty and dark. At least that's how we thought about it for a long time. But now astronomers think something is hiding in the darkness. It's everywhere. It's powerful. And no one knows what it is. They call it dark matter. And when scientists say dark, that really means we don't know, but we're working on it. The first clue that there's something out there in the darkness came from watching how things move in space. Almost everything in space moves in circles. Planets go around stars, stars clump together and swirl around in galaxies, and galaxy clusters spin around one another like bugs flying around a light. About 80 years ago, though, an astronomer named Fritz Zwicky discovered an anomaly. He was studying a group of about 1,000 galaxies known as the Coma Cluster. He wanted to know just how much gravity it took to hold that particular cluster together. Gravity comes from mass, and when Dr. Zwicky calculated the mass of all the galaxies, something didn't add up. The galaxies simply didn't have enough mass by themselves to produce enough gravity to hold the group together. Those galaxies should have been flying away from one another. So, what was holding them together? Dr. Zwicky figured there had to be something else in that cluster that he couldn't see, some sort of invisible mass that was producing extra gravity. And the astounding part was that there seemed to be more of that mystery material in the galaxies than there were stars. Scientists aren't very good at naming things. Whatever was holding everything together was invisible, or dark. And since it was something, it might be matter. So dark matter is what it was called. But how do you study something invisible? Astronomers have found galaxies in space that have been bent out of shape or stretched into long, thin arcs that look like eyebrows. The light from those distant galaxies is distorted by invisible dark matter that lies between us and those galaxies. So even though dark matter is invisible, it gives itself away by distorting light. Scientists think dark matter could be made of invisible particles that are so small they pass right through the Earth. The same way light, which is also made of waves of particles, goes through a window. Scientists have found some invisible particles in space called neutrinos. They come from the sun and other stars in the galaxy, but there are not enough neutrinos in the universe for them alone to make up all dark matter. There must be something else. Some scientists think that the answer lies in massive particles that are invisible, but not very strong. They call them WIMPs, weakly interacting massive particles, because they don't bother interacting with ordinary matter like the stuff you and I are made of. When you drop a ball on a table, it bounces. That's an example of interaction. The ball and the table push against each other. But if you drop a WIMP on the table, it won't bounce. It'll pass right through the table. Then it will continue through the floor, through the Earth, and out the other side into space. So even though a WIMP has more mass than a neutrino, it passes through solid matter as if it weren't there. Remember, this is just a theory. Nobody has actually spotted one of these strange subatomic particles yet. If all the dark matter we're looking for is made of WIMPs, this answers the mystery of what keeps the universe in balance. But if there's something else out there, we have yet to find it. Consider this. When you're outside on a clear, starry night, the blackness you see is what most of the universe is made of. No one knows exactly what that dark stuff is, but it is believed to make up 95% of the universe. What constitutes the rest? Galaxies, stars, planets, and us. Space places. We can study neutrinos, but it's a tricky process. To capture something that travels right through the Earth, you have to go inside the Earth, which isn't easy. Deep underground in northern Ontario is the Sudbury Neutrino Observatory. It uses a big ball filled with a special clear liquid called heavy water that is used inside nuclear reactors. The atoms in this water give off a tiny flash of light if a neutrino hits them. The observatory saw enough flashes to prove that neutrinos exist. Many neutrinos come from the sun, which means they shine down on your head during the day, but since they pass right through the Earth, they also shine up under your feet at night. Now, scientists in the same underground lab can further study the nature of these ghostly particles and are starting to look for others that might be dark matter. 5. Why is the sun so hot? The sun is hot because it's incredibly big. If the sun were a beach ball, the Earth, by comparison, would be the size of a pea. The sun weighs a billion, billion, billion tons. 2 quintillion kilograms. Yes, that's a real number. When an object is that big, even if it's made entirely of gas, its weight squeezes everything together incredibly tightly. And when matter is squeezed together under such enormous pressures, it gets hot. Up to 15 million degrees Celsius, in fact. That's plenty hot enough for the sun's gases to turn into a hot plasma. A plasma is a glowing electrified gas, like the white-hot flash of a lightning bolt, the flame in a fire, or the glow in neon lights are other examples. But none of these are as hot as the plasma at the center of the sun. Atoms in the sun's plasma fly around in all directions, sometimes smashing into one another at high speed and fusing together to make bigger atoms. This is similar to the way 2 water drops might join together in a rain cloud to become a larger one. In the case of plasma, this process of fusion gives off a lot of heat and light, which is the energy that makes the sun shine. In a sense, the sun is a big bomb that never stops exploding. So, why doesn't the sun blow itself to pieces? Because it's big. There's a battle between 2 forces. The endless explosions in the center pushing out and...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.